Hey everyone, my name's Robert and I teach deep learning for SAS. Today we're going to talk about how you can incorporate or use batch normalization in a deep learning model. Now batch normalization is typically used to solve what's called the internal covariate shift problem, or at least mitigate it. Let's talk about the internal covariate shift problem. When you update your neural network, you're updating the weights iteratively, but within each iteration, the weights are updated simultaneous. So when we update a weight, we take a partial derivative of the error function with respect to a particular weight in the model. That gives us our gradient. We then take that gradient and we multiply it by our learning rate, which controls the step size. That gives us our weight update. Once every weight in the model has an update value, we then update our neural networks, and that is an iteration. So let's say that I'm a weight in the model and you're a weight in the model. I'm going to make my move, my update, based on you, how you appear to me, and all the other weights in the model. So I see you. I update based on how you appear to me. I update. I look back at you. And you've changed. Why did you change on me? You changed because you're updating too, and so are all the weights. So every weight update is based upon second and third order effects, other weights in the model. It's something of a moving target, and that's the internal covariate shift problem. So batch normalization normalizes the information being passed between hidden layers in an attempt to mitigate this problem. So when information is passed from one hidden layer to the other, for every mini batch and for every neuron, we calculate a mean and standard deviation. So you also have two learnable constants, which are calculated by the model. Let's take a look at this in SAS. So here I have a program where I'm going to print out several images. It's always a good idea to look at your data. So we have these images here. And I'm going to move this over a little bit. So we have 10 different classes that we're going to predict using a convolutional neural network. We have horses, cats, ships. Is this a ship? Well, maybe our data is a little messy, but it'll suffice. I navigate back to the code, and I'm going to scroll down. Here, I'm just going to summarize the images. And when I summarize the images, I'm looking for the average value per color intensity. I'm going to take these average values and I'm going to use them as offsets in the input layer of my deep learning model. So we have blue, green, and finally red. Now when we build a deep learning model in SAS, it's actually really easy. We start by just building a model shell. So I call build model action, and in the model table equals, I specify some model shell name. This is just going to be a table that's stored in SAS. So I'm going to call this model NoBN for no batch normalization. The type of model that we're going to train is a convolutional neural network, so type equals CNN. Next, I add a series of layers, and for each layer, I'm adding this layer to that model shell, NoBN. You can call your model whatever you would like, my model, my favorite model, your name, your last name, whatever you would like to call your model. So you're adding layers to each to your model shell, and each layer must have its own name. So here I'm calling this layer my input layer. I could call it whatever I would like. Layer equals is where you specify the layer options. So we have type equals. This is an input layer, so we're saying this is an input type. The number of channels, these are color images, so we're going to have three channels. The width and height of these images are 32 by 32. Now we're also applying some random mutations per good practice to help our model generalize to new data. We're applying a horizontal flip transformation as well as a random mutation. So for each mini batch, let's say we pull in 60 or 100 observations for each mini batch, we're going to randomly select some of those images and we're going to horizontally flip them or apply a random mutation. Last but not least, we apply some offsets to this input layer. And these are the all sets that we were able to glean from our data when we summarized the images. After this, I add several convolutional layers. The first layer is going to have convolutional filters that are 3x3 with a stride of 1, and the second convolutional layer is going to have filters 5x5 with a stride of 1. Now, these two convolutional layers, I actually think of these as really being on the same layer, just having different size filters on the same convolutional layer. I then pass this information into a concatenation layer through the source option here. And notice when I highlight this conv layer 1A, it also highlights the name of that layer, that previous layer. And this is how we create the connections. Next, I add a pooling layer. Then I add another convolution, and then a couple of fully connected layers. And last but not least, an output layer. Finally, I train the model using what's called DL train action. And DL train action is really easy. I just specify DL train. Table is the name of the training table that I'd like to train the model on. The model equals is where you specify the model that you're going to apply. So we're creating the model above DL train, and then we're going to take that model that we create and we're applying it to this data here, this small image data shuffled. We're going to train the model for 60 epochs, and then we're going to create an iteration plot. So I'm going to run this program. Now I forgot to highlight it, but in the code, actually you can see it here in the background, we have GPU equals true. To build a deep learning model with lots of parameters, it's probably a good idea to use a GPU. And SAS makes it really easy to use a GPU. You just say GPU equals true. And SAS will go in and find that GPU and use it to train your model. Our model's now done training. So let's take a look at the results. Oh no, what happened? Our model is failing to discriminate between the different classes or predict the different classes. Let's try adding batch normalization to this same model structure and see if we maybe get better results. So in the second program, I have the exact same model structure with the exception that I'm applying batch normalization. So I have my input layer, I have my first two convolutional layers, my concatenation, my pooling, and then my second convolutional layer is where I apply batch normalization. To apply batch normalization, you have to do this in kind of a two-layer step, where the first layer is basically the combination function, and the second layer is where you apply your activation function, but you normalize the data first, using batch normalization. So here we can see that we're adding a layer to this. This is my BN model for batch normalization. Here's the name of the convolutional layer, type equals convo. It's going to have 32 filters. The width and height of these filters are going to be a 5x5, and we're going to use a stride of 2. Now notice that our activation function in this layer is identity, meaning do not transform the net of the combination, or whatever the combination function resolves to. We're just going to pass that forward untransformed. So no transformation is being applied. We then pass the information from this convolutional layer here to the next layer, and this is where we apply batch normalization. So we specify type equals batch norm. In the batch normalization layer, this is where we apply our activation function. Here, I'm using the exponential linear unit. So to implement batch normalization in SAS, it's really easy. You just implement it as a second layer. Now you may notice that earlier in the program, I did not apply batch normalization to my first hidden layer, my first convolutional hidden layer. I did not apply batch normalization here because it has a computational cost to it. It has learnable parameters that you have to calculate. The data is already standardized in the input layer, so I thought, why spend the computation? So that's why I didn't apply it in the first hidden layer. Let's run the program and see how well the model performs. While the model's training, I'm going to tell you a joke. And this is a joke that I made up, so it's nowhere out there. Maybe we'll see it on Reddit after this. But the joke is, you have a statistician and a computer scientist, and they're debating about the terminology used in neural networks. The problem with my joke is that it can fit any situation. Wah, wah, wah. I know, it's not a great joke, but let's take a look at the results. I'm gonna scroll down to my iteration plot. Boom! Our model is now learning the data. Batch normalization, 2 thumbs up. I hope you now have a better understanding of batch normalization and how it can impact a deep learning model. If you like this video, definitely subscribe and click on any of the links below for more resources. Also, if you have any questions or comments, please leave those and I will get back to you. Take care. Adios.